What is going on, guys? Monty Webby here, back again on Thursday. We got a nice 9-game slate here tonight. Little bit of an annoying night last night. James Paxton, I feel like he was just in a home run spot last night, and he wasn't able to get it done. His command wasn't nearly as good. He walked, I believe, 4 guys in 5 innings of work, so wasn't able to capitalize on the great opportunity against Texas, but that can happen sometimes. Ross Stripling, though, had a great night, so if he was your SP2, you're looking pretty good. Maybe you went with Scherzer instead. That was a lot better of a play in hindsight. But yeah, so it was an okay night last night. The hitting that I recommended, most of them only got like singles. They weren't able to capitalize on great opportunities to hit a home run, which I was panning out for, hoping for. But yeah, that can happen sometimes in DFS. Doesn't always work out in your favor. But let's move on to tonight's slate. 9 games, like I said, some good options, especially at hitting. But the thing that's a concern on the slate is that the Yankees-Baltimore game looks like it could easily rain out here tonight, expecting a good amount of rain, and there's going to be a lot of people trying to play that game, I think, because of the Yankees' run total is so high. It's like around 6 almost, and it's just a great matchup for their bats there, so that's a good game to keep an eye on. I won't be covering anyone in that game because the salaries are pretty expensive, and I didn't want to recommend someone that's so big of a play and it just ends up getting rained out. So I'm avoiding that game. But keep that in mind. I would track that Yankees-Baltimore game if you want to attack it. But maybe the ownership will be a little bit lower. Who knows? I don't know. But I got my money 6 for you. 2 pitchers, 3 hitters, and a nice value bat. So go ahead and drop a like on the video before we get going. I would appreciate that if you could do that. Let's try to get around like 80-plus likes again in this one. Thank you so much if we can hit that, and let's just hop into it. I'm going to go with big boy Clayton Kershaw at the top here at 11,800. We could get him at a lower ownership because he is coming off the DL, but I looked up, I was trying to find if they were going to have him on a pitch count or whatever have you, but it looks like Dave Roberts said that he's going to be able to go as far as he's just feeling whatever. They're not going to put a pitch count on his leg. On his start, he's not going to be limiting to any kind of sort of pitch count. So if Kershaw is looking good, and I think he will against this Philly lineup, then he can pitch pretty deep in this game. I think he can honestly get to 6 to 7 innings in this start. And against Philly, their lineup just doesn't look nearly as scary with Hoskins out. I know that Hoskins wasn't hitting the ball well at all, but he did provide a nice power upside to this lineup. So with him out, they're very strikeout prone. Or not very, but pretty damn strikeout prone across the board. And Vegas likes Kershaw a lot in the start. 2.9 runs projected. And another thing here is that Kershaw, his pitch speed and stuff like that wasn't looking very good the start of the season. So he might have been dealing with this injury that put him on the DL in his first couple starts. So like he was kind of struggling in most of these starts, like 2 Kershaw standards. He only got over 20 drafting points, what, twice? And like, what? How many starts did he have? 8 starts. So 2 out of his 8 starts, he got over 20 twice. So that's definitely concerning for Kershaw's stock. But the fact that he put him on the DL, I think he got more healthy and just like a nice little rejuvenation for Kershaw here. So I think coming out in the start, he's going to be motivated. And this guy is elite in LA, especially at home. Throughout his career, you can see kind of the DraftKings splits there that he's just much better at home here. So in this game at home against Philly, who'll be facing another park downgrade here, I like Kershaw a lot. I think he can get a good amount of strikeouts and just have a good start. Like, people were overly concerned about him. I think he's going to try to put those concerns to a rest here in the start. So I'm going to go ahead and lock him in there. And for my second guy, we're going to go with another lefty, Jose Quintana here at 7,500. Similar to Kershaw, the part that he'll be pitching in, I think, will benefit him as well because out of Coors Field, this guy is much better. In Coors Field, it's been a disaster this year. If you look at the splits, 10 drafting points on average compared to 17 on the road. So being in New York here will help, and he has a great matchup against these Mets bats. They struggle a lot against lefties. They only have a 216 average against them and a 27% K rate. So Quintana can get some good amount of strikeouts, maybe like 6 to 7, like we've seen in the last 3 games. He's just really struggled against San Fran and Atlanta for whatever reason. Atlanta is very good against lefties, but San Fran, that was a little bit of a weird start, but that was in Wrigley, like I said, got beat up pretty hard there. So I think in this matchup, though, against the Mets, he can get a good amount of strikeouts. There's not many power guys at all against the lefties in this lineup. Most of the guys remaining are lefty power guys, like Frazier is out, Cespedes is out. So those are the two main guys that are good against lefties that will give you some fits. But the rest of the lineup seems like smooth sailing for Quintana. There is a small concern with his command. It's been up and down. He's been walking a good amount of guys this year. But if he can keep that under control, he can reach that upside that he's shown in some of these games, like 30 DraftKings points, 21, 32. So I think he can get 20-plus DraftKings points again in this game at a nice price at 7,500 because he does have those small concerns. But I'll take the opportunity at a small price tag. So I'm going to go ahead and lock him in there. And those are the two pitchers. You got Kershaw and Quintana, and still 3,800 remaining per player. So for my first guy, I'm going to go with George Springer here at 4,800 going against Drew Pomeranz. Pomeranz has been pitching atrocious this year. His ERA is like over 5, just not good at all. And he's been allowing a lot of home runs, especially to right-handed batters. So if you look at the splits, he's allowed 2.1 home runs per 9 to righties, and a 415 wOBA against them. So righties are hitting the ball very well against them. We know that Springer throughout his career has great power against lefty pitchers, and he just has great base hitting ability. So I think he can get like a double or a home run against Pomeranz in this spot. And they're projected, I believe, like 5.3 runs or something around there. And with Springer at the top of the lineup, you can easily get 5 at-bats and a good opportunity. If you can see Pomeranz like twice, maybe even 3 times in this stint, I think he can just get one off him. So George Springer, 4,800, not a bad price tag. And he's normally around like when he is just hitting the ball well, he can get up to 5,000, especially against the lefties. But at 4,800, I like the price tag. Lock him in there. So that's the first guy. And for my second guy, Gene Segura at 4,600 here, going against the lefty. Another guy that's very good against lefties. He hits for a great average. His batting average against lefties on the season is a 359. And he's been hitting the ball very well in these last couple games. We've seen double digits in the last 5 games. I think he can make it a 6-1 here against Mike Minor. And the thing with this the spot that I like a lot about Segura is the fact that if he can get on base, I think he can easily get a stolen base because Mike Minor can be stolen on. Segura has done it against him in the past. He's been on base, I think, 4 times against them, and he's gotten 2 stolen bases against them. So he has the opportunity to get a stolen base. And also the catcher for Texas has been one of the worst catchers in the league of holding runners on or just throwing them out. So Segura, if he throws or if he tries to steal a base, he's probably going to get it done. So he has the upside of getting a few hits and getting a stolen base. And that gives him a good like 20-plus ceiling, honestly. If he can do that, he does have some small home run ability. So I think he has the opportunity to get it done in multiple facets, which I like about DraftKings hitters when they can get like a stolen base, maybe a double, a home run. They're just going to get it done in multiple ways. So he's a very safe play. Like him a lot. Go ahead and lock him in there. And for my third guy, another guy against a lefty here. Guess that's the theme of the videos. The theme of this video is like lefty pitchers, but Hunter Renfro at 3,600. Nice little value play, I think, here against Chen, the pitcher for Miami. And with Chen, he's been allowing a lot of home runs to right-handed batters, similar to Drew Pomeranz. He's allowing 2 home runs per 9 innings to righties. And he's not really striking them out at all with only a 10% K rate against righties. So that's perfect for Renfro. He does strike out a lot, but when if he has that added advantage of a pitcher that's not really striking out righties, then he can kind of tee off more against this lefty. He had a 368 ISO against lefties last year, so he definitely has power against lefties. And at 3,600, offers good upside with that home run ability. Just one swing of the bat can give you that value for Renfro. So I'm going to go ahead and lock him in there at 3,600. And that's your core 5. You got Kershaw, Quintana, Segura, George Springer, and Renfro. So those are the guys. And for my value guy, I'm going to go with Justin Bour. He's kind of been sliding under the radar this year, but he's had some great power. 10 home runs. 9 out of those 10 home runs, I believe, have come against right-handed pitchers. And against Lyles for San Diego, he was very bad against left-handed batters. Last year, he allowed over a 300 average and around like 2 home runs per 9 two left-handed batters. So Boer, a very powerful lefty, I think can get a few hits off him or maybe even a home run. We've seen throughout his career that he has great power against right-handed pitchers. And the park downgrade isn't that severe. Like, Miami is a pretty pitcher-friendly park. So it's going to San Diego, it's not like it's going to kill Boer. I think here he's been hitting well in the stadium. The two out of the three games, he got a double twice. 10 DraftKings points, 2 out of the 3. He did have a tough night last night, but I think he can bounce back here, hitting the ball very well besides that game. So Justin Boer, a guy with good upside at 3,400. I'm going to go ahead and lock him in there. So that is it with the plays. You got 3,575 remaining per player. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Be sure to leave a like before you head out if you did. And hit that subscribe button if you aren't subscribed to the channel as well. It really helps me out. Supporting the channel and just gets you some good DraftKings picks every single day. Guys to consider, if you don't want to play him, you don't have to play him, maybe can help you with like considering ownership on some of these guys, because most of my plays, especially the pitcher side of things, can be cash game based. Like, I'm not going to recommend like these crazy like hit or miss guys, but I'm trying to recommend guys that can just get it done and just be productive at the any given slate. So these guys I feel safe about. So definitely you can consider some ownership with my plays. So maybe if you want to pivot off these guys, maybe you think I have no idea what I'm talking about, then you can pivot off these guys. Like, just do whatever the hell you want with my advice. But this is what I'm thinking on this slate. I hope you guys enjoyed. Comment any questions you might have in the comment section. And you can follow me on Twitter at MoneyWebby. I post some fantasy baseball season-long articles that I write. If you're interested in some advice for like trading for guys, I talk about buy low, sell high candidates like every single week. And also, I'm going to be writing some fantasy football season articles. So definitely follow me there at MoneyWebby if you want to give those a read. Some good content there, some good stats and stuff to consider for fantasy football and fantasy baseball season-long content. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video, though. Good luck here on this 9-game slate, and we'll see you back here again tomorrow.